As you can see, we managed to lose only 8% performance from compared to all low, while having the game look almost exactly like all ultra. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to my video. Today we're taking a look at Rust, where we'll take a look at the different settings, how to compare in terms of FPS and fidelity, and lastly, I'll show my own optimized settings that I would personally use. If you have any suggestions for future games you would like for me to analyze, feel free to write them in the comments below. If you liked the video, please like and consider subscribing for future videos. I have divided the video into chapters or parts to make it easier for you to see the performance of the specific settings you are interested in, which you can find either in the description below or just see on the timeline of the video. Once the video begins, you'll be able to see the name of the setting, the percentile difference, and the average FPS. I recorded all my footage in 1440p, upscaled to 5K. This was done to ensure that my PC was used to its fullest, but also to allow me to test the game in multiple resolutions when needed. My own specs is an Core i7-8700K, overclocked to 4.8GHz, and a 3090. I'm excited to test Rust, since this is a game that's been developing for many years and has changed quite a lot over the years. Not only in terms of features added to the game, but also in terms of graphics and performance. You should all try to find a video on how the game looked back in beta around 7 years ago, and I believe it's the same game. Before we go into the specific settings, I wanted to showcase the two extremes of all low and all ultra, to see both the performance and quality difference between the two. This is the footage running in the background. There's a few points to take from this. Firstly, the game uses a lot of RAM, no matter your settings, so expect to have around 7 to 8 GB of RAM available. Secondly, the game uses a lot of VRAM, with one particular setting using the most VRAM, which you'll see later in the video. Lastly, it's important to keep in mind this game is badly optimized in certain scenarios. Like for an example, when you're in an area with a lot of player-made items and player-made buildings. As you can see in the video, there's a 63% difference between all low and all ultra, so we have a lot of headroom we can work with. So let's get started. The first setting we're going to take a look at is nudity. Inside nudity, we have three different options. We can either select uncensored, pixelated, or underwear. And surprisingly, there is actually a difference in FPS depending on what setting you choose. So uncensored and underwear will be about the same. There's really no difference in FPS here. However, if you do choose pixelated, you will actually lose a couple of percentile FPS. Which does actually make sense when you think about it, because your PC now has to render those extra pixels to cover the specific areas of the different naked people running around. As in this example, you can see there's only one guy. But if you actually had multiple naked people running around you, I won't judge why you have that, you could actually lose a lot of FPS. So here I would definitely recommend to either use uncensored or underwear, whichever one you prefer of the two. Next up we have max skips. Max skips determines how many debris will appear when you're destroying different buildings and houses made by other players or by yourself for that instance. As you can see, this has a huge impact on your FPS. The FPS I've shown here is not the usually average FPS I've shown in the video, but it's actually the 0.1 percentile low. So that this is the lowest FPS I got while recording in front of the building while it was being destroyed. This means that while I had it at 0, I dropped down to 61 FPS. And while I had it at 2000, I had it drop all the way down to 40.90 FPS. So this has a huge impact on your FPS while you're destroying other people's houses. For instance, in raids. Therefore, I would definitely recommend in any competitive setting to have this all the way down to 0. Next up, we have graphics quality. Graphics quality determines the quality of different graphics inside the game. As you can see, this has a huge impact on your VRAM usage. When we have it at 0, we're using around 3600 megabytes, and once we turn it all the way up to 6, you can add the extra 4800 megabytes onto that, which is around 8.5 GB of VRAM totally. This game generally uses a lot of VRAM, so this setting, the recommendation I'll make for this setting will depend a lot on the VRAM you have. If you have the available VRAM, you might want to go all the way up to 6. However, if you don't have that much VRAM, this is definitely the setting you want to be turning down, because this is the setting with the most impact on your VRAM usage. It is also worth pointing out that the VRAM usage was taken while having all the other settings at around medium, and is taken from 1440p. So if you're playing in 1080p, it will be a bit lower. If you're playing in 4K, it will be a bit higher. Next up, we have shadow quality. Shadow quality determines the quality of the different shadows inside the game. As you can see in this example, there's not that much of a difference in terms of quality between the different settings. However, you do lose a lot of FPS going from 0 all the way up to 3. Therefore, in this case, I recommend to have this either on 0 or 1. If you want to have it look a bit better, you can choose 1, since you only lose a couple of FPS, but if you really need all of the FPS, I would choose 0. Next up, we have Shadow Cascades. Shadow Cascades adjust the number of Shadow Cascades in the game. This means that it also adjusts the number of shadows you'll be able to see. As you can see here in my example, we have more shadows once we turn it up to 2 or all the way up to 4. As you will also notice, there's no performance difference between having it on 0 and having it on 2, even though we do gain some more shadows and some more graphical fidelity from doing so. However, once we go from 2 to 4, we lose around 6% performance. Therefore, I would recommend to either have this at 0 or maybe at 2. I do also want to point out that once I put it to 2, which you can also see in the video, the shadows are a bit flaky and glitchy in a way. I don't know why. I don't know if that was just the one time or what. It's just me it's affecting. But if that's happening for you, I would definitely go down to 0 instead, because that's really annoying and distracting. Otherwise, if you're not experiencing that, take it up to 2. Next up, we have Shadow Light. Shadow Light determines the amount of shadows that will appear from man-made light. So that means light from your torch, from your bonfire, and anything else that emits light that you or some other player has created. So this will not be affected by any natural light, so from the sun or the moon, anything like that. As you can see, this does not have any difference in terms of your FPS. So this is more of a personal preference, whether you like it or not. However, I do want to say that in a competitive environment, it might be beneficial to have this at 0, because you can see much clearer where other people might see shadows. Next up, we have water quality. Water quality determines the quality of the water inside the game. And to be more specific, it determines the amount of waves you'll see on the water. So again, this is it's a bit more of a personal preference. I would probably recommend to have this at 0, just to gain the extra FPS while you're maybe sailing or running on the beach. Next up, we have water and world reflections. I have chosen to take both of these settings and compare them at the same time, because they kinda do the same thing. Water reflections control the reflections you can see inside the underwater, and world reflections control the reflection you'll see on different shiny objects in the game. As you can see, these two settings combined has a huge impact on your FPS. However, as you will probably also notice, is there's no difference whatsoever in quality of the game. And I have tried different places at different times of the day to see if I could notice any difference in these reflections, but I could not find any. And since you're losing so much FPS from having this turned on, I would definitely recommend to have this at 0, because you're not going to notice any difference beside in your FPS. Next up, we have shader level. Shader level determines the distance from the player in which certain textures will load in. So while we have it at 100, we have a lot of textures that's not loaded in on the hill behind or the small field in front of us. As we move up, this will slowly become more and more and will start to look a lot nicer. In this example, I would recommend to have it at least 500. If you go up to 600, you lose a lot more FPS and you don't gain really any fidelity. And between 300 and 500, you don't lose any FPS, but you do gain a lot of fidelity. And 100 you can use 100 if you really need the FPS, but it can also look really ugly. So I would probably recommend either 500 or 100. Next up, we have draw distance. Draw distance determines how far away different objects will load in. As you can see, there's a huge difference between 500 and up to 1500. However, after we pass 1500, it's very difficult to see any difference, if there even is any difference. Therefore, I would recommend to leave this at around 1500. If you really need the FPS, you could go down to 1000, but since there's no difference in FPS between 500 and 1000, there's no reason to go below 1000. In conjunction with the last one, we now have shadow distance. Shadow distance determines how far away different shadows will load in on the different objects in the game. So you can see while we have it at 50, we only see the shadows right in front of us. And once we turn it up to 100, the shadows from the trees right in front of, a little bit further in front of me, start to load in. However, after 100, there's not really any difference, which I find a bit odd. I tried to test it in several locations and I took all the shadow settings and turned them up to the max, but it didn't seem to make any difference. Therefore, I would just recommend to leave this at 100. Next up, we have anisotropic filtering. Anisotropic filtering increases the details and textures, especially those viewed either out in the distance or viewed at an angle. In this example, you can take a look at the mountains or hills out in the distance and see the changes in detail on the different rocks. As you can see, there's a very, very narrow difference in quality between having it on 1 and having it on 16. However, you do lose around 10% between those two settings. Another thing I would like to add is that between having it on 4 and having it on 16, you only lose around 2% performance. So if you're going to choose 4, you might as well just use 16. In my testing, I also looked into different resolutions, but that didn't seem to make any difference. And I also looked into revamp usage, but it didn't make any difference there either. Here, I would recommend to either have this at 1 or have it at 16. And since there's not that much difference in terms of fidelity, I would recommend to leaving this at 1. Next up, we have parallax mapping. Parallax mapping adds some extra geometrical details to the smaller rocks and dirt roads in the game. It's hard to show in this video, but there is actually a small difference between the different settings while you're in-game. You can see it, however it is fairly subtle, and you only notice it while you're actually trying to see it. So you have to be staring at the different rows or the different rocks to actually see the difference. Therefore, I would definitely recommend to leave this at 0. You could maybe bump it up to run if you want, if you feel like it actually it looks a lot better for you, but otherwise I would just recommend to use 0. Next up, we have grass displacement. Grass displacement makes it so that while you are running or walking on the grass will displace itself to make it look a bit more realistic. However, in this game, as you can probably tell from the video, which I have slowed down to try to make it even easier for us to notice, it can be really difficult to actually notice that in action. I did also, while recording this, have all the other grass settings turned up to the max to ensure that there was nothing else that was impairing me from making a proper comparison. Therefore, I would definitely recommend to leave this off. Next up, we have particle quality. Particle quality determines the quality of the different particles in the game. This is especially shown within fires or smoke coming from those fires. As you can see in the example here, it doesn't seem to make that much of a difference going from 0 up to 50, both in terms of quality and FPS. However, once you go from 50 and up to 100, you do lose around 3% FPS. And do also keep in mind, this is just a small example. If you're in a large area with a lot of different fires going on, you could actually lose a lot of FPS from this. So this is a setting I would either recommend to leave at 0 or maybe up to 50 if you want the different fires to maybe look a bit better. Next up, we have object quality. Object quality determines the quality of the different non-player made buildings. So all the different buildings that's already in the game while you're spawning in the map. That could, for an example, be the lighthouse that I'm currently in. As you can see, it has the biggest impact on the interior of these buildings. You can see there's a huge difference going just from 0 up to 100, where we suddenly get the post on the wall, we get the green paint, and other smaller items inside the house. This is more of a personal preference because you don't lose that much FPS, and it's only noticeable while you're actually inside these buildings. So I would recommend to leave this at either 0 or 100. If you leave it at 100, you want to look a bit nicer, or leave it at 0 if you really want to get every piece of FPS you can. Next up, we have tree quality. Tree quality is split out into two settings in this game. So we have tree quality itself, which is the one we're looking at right now, which determines how far in the distance the different trees will load in. And we have max tree meshes, which we will cover right after this one, which determines the quality of the trees that are actually loaded in. So this setting could also be called tree distance, in correlation with draw distance and shadow distance. So it determines how far away the different trees will load in. As you can see, there's a big difference between having this at 0 or having this at 100. I would definitely recommend to leave this at 100 because it's worth losing that 5% of FPS to get that better draw distance on the trees, because otherwise the game can look really ugly. If we then take a look at max tree meshes, like I said, that determines the actual quality of the trees that's loaded in. So you have now chosen maybe 100. That's the distance how far in the, on the tree quality. That's how distance how far the different trees will load in. Here you need now to determine what will the quality of those trees that are loaded in be. So as you can see, and I just want to mention, I tested max tree meshes with tree quality on the max. So we were loading as many trees in as we could. You can see there's a big difference in actual quality of the trees. So if you only leave this at 10, it doesn't leave that much for the trees to be loaded in, so they will all look blocky and ugly. I'd recommend to leave this at least 50, And if you can spare the FPS, go the way all the way up to 100, because this is one of the settings that will impact the quality of the game the most. It also impact your FPS a lot, I know that, but it can look really, really ugly when you have it on the lowest setting. Next up, we have terrain quality. Terrain quality determines the quality of the terrain. As you can see on the pathway here in front of me beneath the telephone poles, that can make a difference in the game. On the left, where we have it all the way down to 0, it looks a bit dark and untextured. And once we go up to 50, it starts to get textured and look a lot nicer. However, once we go from 50 to 100, there's not that much of a difference. I couldn't really notice any difference. So I would just recommend to leave this at 50 to, you only lose around 1% FPS. And it looks a lot nicer. Next up, we have grass quality. Grass quality determines both the quality of the grass, but also the density, the amount of the grass. However, as you can see in this game, there's not that much of a difference between 0 to 100. I really can't notice any difference at all. So I would just recommend to leave this at 0. Next up, we have decor quality. Decor quality determines the amount of flowers you'll see around the map on the different planes of grass. So as you can see, once you have it turned down to 0, you completely eliminate the flowers, and once you turn up to 100, you get a lot of flowers in the fields. This barely affects your FPS, so this is more of a personal preference how many flowers you would like to see in the game. Next up, we have anti-aliasing. Anti-aliasing removes jagged edges from the game and makes it look a lot more smooth and generally nicer. As you can see, this does have a fairly high impact on your performance, but not as high as it usually is in other games. So you will lose around 10% going from having it turned off all the way up to TSSAA. For my recommendation, I'll be dividing this into three categories, one for 4K, one for 1440p, and one for 1080p. And this is done because anti-aliasing is based off your resolution. So the higher resolution you have, the less you need anti-aliasing to make the game look better, basically. Therefore, for 4K, I recommend to use FXAA. There's no need to go higher than that, you'll just lose FPS. There's no visual difference after that. For 1440p, I recommend SMAA. And lastly, for 1080p, since this is the lowest resolution, I recommend to use TSAA. This does also have the highest performance hit, but I definitely feel like this is worth it for people playing in 1080p. Next up, we have depth of field. Depth of field adds a filter over your screen, which makes it so that everything else besides the specific thing you're looking at will get a blurry filter on top of it. As you can see, this is most noticeable in this video with the large tree on the right side of the two examples, where you can see on the left it's much clearer to look at compared to the right. This is definitely something I would recommend to turn off, both because you take a huge hit to your FPS, around 14%, and because I also just personally find it very annoying to get everything else blurry. It can be really disadvantageous in a competitive situation. Next up, we have ambient occlusion. Ambient occlusion adds extra soft shadows to different crevices and generally to any place where you have two objects in very close proximity of one another. In my example here, which I have tested with all the other shadow settings turned up to the max, you can see it has a huge difference both in terms of FPS, but also in terms of fidelity. However, since this is a more of a competitive game and since you do lose a lot of FPS, around 15% from having it on, I would still recommend to leave this off. It's not something you're gonna... It is maybe something you would notice in terms of quality, but not that much, and it's worth having those extra FPS. Next up, we have high quality bloom. High quality bloom adds extra details to very sharp objects of light. So that could be, for instance, like you see in this video, the sun. I would recommend to leave this off because it might not give you any difference in terms of FPS. And it's a very slight difference in terms of fidelity, but it makes the sun a bit more sharp, which can be really annoying in a competitive environment if you are against the sun while trying to fight an enemy. Next up, we have lens dirt. Lens dirt adds some extra dirt and fogginess to the screen. It can be kind of hard to show here, but if you look around the edges of your screen when you have it turned on or off, you'll notice that it looks a bit more foggy and a bit more gritty. So this is a more of a personal preference. It doesn't really hurt your performance or fidelity for that matter, so you choose for yourself. Next up, we have motion blur. Motion blur adds some extra blurriness to the image while you're moving around. So as you can see in my example, on the left side where we have it turned it off, we can clearly see the tree all the way, no matter how much I'm moving. However, to the right, it's very blurry while we're moving around. So this is definitely something I would recommend to turn off, both because we lose around 15% performance from having it turned on, but also because it can be a big disturbance while playing a competitive shooter. Next up we have sunshafts. Sunshafts add some extra light from very bright light sources, so that will be the sun or the moon. And like my recommendation was with the high quality bloom, I will also recommend to leave this off because it can be kind of annoying to have extra light right shining in your face while you're trying to fight enemies. Next up we have sharpen, and sharpen, funnily enough, sharpens the image to make it look a bit more crisp. I tested this both in 5K, like what you're watching right now, and also in 1080p because I was wondering why I couldn't see any difference, but I just can't see any difference. This is one of the settings where the developers themselves have actually added a note and said that it doesn't affect your performance, and the performance even I found was so small that I think they might be right. So this is something you will have to test for yourself. Go in, enable it. Can you see any difference? If not, turn it off. If you can, great. Leave it on. Next up we have Vignette. Vignette reduces the light at the edge of the screen to add a more cinematic effect to the game. This means that the edge of your screen will be a little bit darker compared to the rest of the screen. This doesn't affect your performance at all, so this is a more personal preference. If you like the look, you can enable it. If you don't, you can disable it. Next up we have the experimental settings. First up we have occlusion calling. Occlusion calling helps your system to choose what to render based on your line of sight. However, the experience you will have with this enable depends on the system you have. A lot of lower end system might get stuttering because of this, because the objects are loaded in and then unloaded rapidly. So this is something you will have to test for yourself on your own system to see how it works. If you don't see any improvement from having this on, or if you experience stutters especially, leave this off. I would just generally recommend to try it out. If it doesn't help you, just leave it off. Next up we have grass shadows. Grass shadows add some extra shadows to the grass inside the game. I tested it with this with all the other shadow settings set to the max. Even though this does make a slight difference to the quality of the game, it's not something I feel like most people would notice, and since it does impact your performance around 3%, I would recommend to having this off. Next up we have contact shadows. Contact shadows adds extra shadows plus adds extra detail to the already existing shadows inside the game. This was tested with all the other shadow settings turned up to the max. And as you can see, it does make a huge difference both in terms of FPS, around 10%, but also in terms of fidelity, where it does actually look a bit nicer with the different shadows enabled. However, since it is shadows and it's not something that's the most important part of this game, I would recommend to having this off because you do gain around 10% FPS from having it turned off. Here are my own recommended settings. These are the ones I would personally use, and they're based off the recommendations I have made throughout the video. Do keep in mind that these settings is based off my own hardware and yours is different, therefore you need to watch the video and select the settings best suited for your system. I have also made a graph in which you will be able to see the performances in percentage over the top 6 different settings. You can use this graph to find the most important settings and adjust them. Do please provide feedback on the graph, what you think about it, how it should be structured, and how I can make it better for you guys. Lastly, I also wanted to show the performance of my recommended settings, given that I'm currently rocking an i7-8700K overclocked to 4.8GHz with a 3090. And that's the footage you're seeing right now in the background. As you can see, we managed to lose only 8% performance from compared to all low, while having the game look almost exactly like all ultra, which really goes to show how big of a difference the right settings can make. But thank you all for watching. If you made it this far and be able to use this video to get better FPS in Rust, please like and subscribe for future videos where we'll take a look at other games. If you have any suggestions for those other games I should make a video on, please leave it in the comments below. If you have any other feedback for the videos, please leave those in the comments below as well. And if you have any other tips or tricks or anything you noticed while playing Rust that could gain people some more FPS, please share them in the comments below as well. If you're interested in these kinds of videos, maybe check out the video I made on Ark Survival Evolved or Warzone. Have a nice day. Bye bye.